Okay, a very good evening to one and all present here. Thank you all for joining us on the Saturday evening. Mental health is important for all of us. I'm sure that all of you agree. Especially in this current situation where all of us are forced to stay homes and not interact much with our own peers or our own family, mental health plays a very important role, and it also helps us in maintaining a good health, right? So I would strongly say your mind is the most powerful tool that you have. If your mind is strong, so is your body. So I keep saying this, my mind rules my body. So whatever comes, if I decide I have to do, I will do it. So my request to all of you is to keep the mind really strong so that it dominates your body and, you know, doesn't let you go down in any way, right? So now I'm really happy. We're really happy to have Dr. Pradeep Palaniappan with us. So Dr. Pradeep Palaniappan is a psychiatrist. He has done his post-graduation from NIMHANS, the National Institute of Mental Health Sciences, from Bangalore. And he continued to work there as a senior resident for 2 more years. After that, he also moved to PhD as an assistant professor. And right now he is there as an associate professor. So during his tenure, he has worked in geriatric clinics, both in NIMHANS as well as in PSG, and has been involved in the assessment and the treatment of various degrees of mental health in seniors, right? He has also been involved in as a chief resource person of many conferences, and also published many research in many journals as well. So before we invite Dr. Pradeep, I would say keep the spirits high, keep the mind in vigor, and make your body stronger. So with this, we would like to invite Dr. Pradeep to take over the session. I'm sure he will be able to guide us much better as to how to keep our mental health sound and safe, right? Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for coming over.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. If I'm not audible, kindly let me know so that change it as well. Okay. So good evening all. Thanks, Sunan, for a very kind introduction. I understand that this program has been going on for some days by now, and I heard that it has made a very good progress, and I heard that many are really growing younger as the day has progressed. So I also feel that I will also stick on to the note which you told, that is, mind rules the body. So in this scenario, what I thought is that I will have two parts of a discussion in this next few minutes. The first part of the discussion will probably focus more on what are all the symptoms the seniors can have, especially the mental health issues, what are all the symptoms they can have, and how, if at all, we can also recognize in ourselves, and also if at all someone known to us has similar symptoms, it will be easy for us to actually recognize them and help them and then guide them to the correct person for the treatment. That will be one part. Whereas the second part, I thought I will focus more on if at all such mental health issues are there. In that case, probably how we can do some techniques so that we can control those symptoms by ourselves. So these are the two parts which I'm going to focus on. In the middle, if anyone have any queries, kindly you can always stop in the middle of the presentation and always ask me. I can always get back to the questions then and there. Okay, is it okay? Can I proceed on with that? Yeah, okay. So Sunand, I think I will give instruction to the Sunand to change the slides. Okay, can you change, Sunand? Yeah. So I am starting with this, saying that actually this is a famous quote which have come up in this recent past, that India is actually graying. What does actually mean? So in here, when we compare, there was a study which looked into how the population will be there in India. Let's say they stretch from 2000, and then they thought how the 2050 population will be there at India. So what they have predicted is that overall in India, the population will grow as to a 55% more. And next one. And in that category, what we will know as of now is at least aged population of 60 years and above will increase by 326%. And age group above 80 plus by around 700%. This inflated number is probably because growing life expectancy. So the mortality or the death has been controlled with advancements in technology, and probably as a result of which the life expectancy of Indians have also gone up. So that is one of the reasons that the inflated the figures are all indicates that a significant number of people above 60 will be there in 2050. Okay. So this is not this is a specific thing from the United Nations Epidemiological Service. So in that case, why are we bothered about mental health in elderly? Because I would rather say it is a silent epidemic. Many of the times, there are mental health issues in elderly. Many times it is not spoken much because probably many feel very stigmatized. It is not easily communicated between people, probably because of the fear of discrimination. But still, that epidemic is gradually there, and it is silent, at the same time growing gradually up. Okay, so initially, during around 30, 40 years back, it was thought that it is as less as 2.3% of elderly have some mental health issues. Later, what we have found out that it is almost 30 to 35% of elderly people have some amount of mental health issues. What I am here wanted to emphasize is that I am not here to probably threaten people with data, but this is probably can be taken more as an awareness so that let me be aware that this is what is happening. And probably if there are some symptoms or anything we have, it is perfectly okay to talk about it, because it looks like many people may have similar issues in our country as well. Okay, and it is also found that our age population are at probably 10 times the risk for any psychological problem when compared to that the younger population. Probably multiple causes are there, which we will gradually go on one by one. Yeah, so next one. So is it ignored or underreported? So many times what is ignored is probably looking for mental health issues in elderly. Is it being adequately looked for, or are we being ignoring, or are we underreporting? I will say both we are doing. So sometimes the issue is why we are ignoring, because the common myths which we have is that anything which happens during the aging, people say it is a part of normal aging. And many attitude factors which the young people have, that it is not a serious issue when something happens in elderly person. Okay, and elderly people also come to the conclusion that they live with it. No cure is probably possible. Probably they also start to assume that these mental health issues or psychological problems are all part of our karma or the fate. Okay, so and also elderly hesitate to seek any mental health services. Probably they feel very burdened to their younger population. So I've personally seen so many elderly who does not speak about all these issues, just because just revealing them to the younger population, the younger population or the son or the daughter has to take them to their relevant doctor, which they feel they are burdening their children. So many times they hesitate to even say their symptoms to their son or daughter. They are also fearful that they are being humiliated for repeated body symptoms. So this is a common thing which many people have, that many times in elderly, we have a lot of bodily problems like pain symptoms, or fatigue, tiredness, which keep changing week after the week. And many times, if we, let's say we go and meet a gastroenterologist on the first week, the next week, sometimes we may have, let's say we have symptoms like heart pounding, then we go to a cardiologist and meet. So many times they feel that the younger generation probably gets humiliated when we repeatedly say one or the other body symptoms. So that is one of the reasons they also hesitate to seek services. Similarly, they are also fearful that actually treatment will worsen whatever is the issue, already existing issues are. And to complicate the problem, I think we as practitioners also have a poor understanding, and many times we may ignore the elderly when they come for some symptoms or the other. So with all this, many times it is ignored and also underreported. Okay. Yeah. So if we look out, what are the common psychiatric problems that are there, like which are under-identified or ignored, the most common is probably depression. These are the actual figures from the Indian studies. It is not from an abroad data. So it is as high as 22 to 50%. So when we say 22 to 50%, what I mean is, these are symptoms where people can have on and off a dull mood, sadness, or it may be most part of the day for several weeks. Some people can have for several years. So this can, all these people are grouped together and then called as depression in this slide. So it is as high as 22 to 50%. So what are the common symptoms with which people with depression present? So they may feel sad most part of the day, and most of the times they may lose interest in the activities which they were very happy doing in the past. Let's say they lose interest in watching TV or following a serial or knitting or gardening or cooking. So gradually it becomes very, very tiresome for them, and they start to become more burdensome for the others. They start to lament to their son or the daughter saying that I'm burdening you, and they may start to feel hopeless of anything good thing in the future. And also many of the times the sleep disturbance seems to be one of the most common symptom in elderly who have depression. And also they may lose appetite gradually. So initial phase, there may be a lot of hesitancy saying that these are all part of the normal aging. But later, they understand that even though they want to eat, but they have lost their appetite to eat. Okay, so they have lost their ability to taste the food like past. And also they have, many people can start to feel a lot of pain all over the body. And many times, it may not be in one single place. Sometimes on one week, it may be on the right arm. The next week, it may be on the left arm or in the back. It keeps changing most of the time. And they may also perceive a tingling sensation in the arms. They may have burning sensation in the arms, sometimes headache. Like this, variable symptoms at various points of time. And also sometimes the unspoken truth is that they may have sometimes death wishes as well. So all this had to be carefully looked for if we have, or whether anyone we are interested in also have. Okay. So next slide, please. Hello. Hi. Sunan, the next slide,
yeah,
please.
Oh, yeah.
The next common thing which is commonly under-identified or ignored is anxiety disorders. It's as high as 20%. These are common fears which occur are fear of death, the fear of gasping. Sometimes they may be hyperventilating a lot. Sometimes they may feel really fearful of being alone. Sometimes there may be preoccupations about financial issues. So because of all this, they may have a lot of anxiety problems. Many times these anxiety problems can be triggered by multiple causes. The most common being isolation. We do see a lot of people with who are elderly who have to stay alone while all their son and daughter would have gone somewhere else and settled there and will be working over there. So they feel that they are probably more isolated, and or sometimes in this pandemic scenarios, a relative sense of insecurity about life also brings up the anxiety. Sometimes I think everyone would have experienced this, the death of a known person in this pandemic. Sometimes that can also trigger an anxiety symptoms. Some gradually along the way, they start to lose the purpose of life, sometimes feel very estranged, and they have lack of social connectedness. All this results in a lot of anxiety symptoms like fear of death and other things, which may also result in a lot of disturbances. And it may disturb their regular sleep routine, their ability to cook. Everything can be disturbed because of these fear and these triggering factors. Next one, yeah. The other common thing which is seen in elderly is also dementia. It is only 1-6%. It's a rare problem, but still it is a common thing in the elderly, which we should be proactively looking for. Let's say some can present with memory problems, like inability to remember names of some of the objects. Let's say they have difficulty in remembering what is the name of the tumbler is, or to name a pen as a pen, or to name a bottle as a bottle. Okay, so they may have, they may be not be able to put that correct word to actually take a, say that it is a bottle. Okay. Sometimes they may gradually observe they may have difficulty in calculation, or they may not be able to read and understand the newspapers of late, or inability to remember even directions to the home. So they may gradually need help in calculation of some expenses. They may have difficulty in filling up the bank checks, sometimes writing the date, the pay, and all those in a wrong places, which results in bouncing of the checks. Sometimes they have difficulty in paying electricity bills or organizing purchases from a grocery store or shopping. These are all some of the things if we are, we have to think in this way as well. The other common, Sunanta. The other common thing is the 50 to 70% of the people have sleep problems. So either they may have, they are unable to get into the sleep, or they may wake up early from the sleep, or the sometimes if they, because of nature calls, they wake up in the middle of the night, they take a long time to sleep. Some people can have very poor quality, but many people adjust the sleep problems, accept this as a part of the aging, and they don't get treated at all. And sometimes in some people, if it is not treated adequately, can also result in a lot of psychological impairment, that seeing that, I am not able to sleep in the like in the past. So I may not have, I may have a problem tomorrow to work. I may have a memory problem. These type of anxiety symptoms also starts, and that creates a separate type of an anxiety. Similarly, they are also fearful of getting any treatment. I understandably, many of the general physicians or psychiatrists can prescribe some medicines which you can become addicted to. So many people fear that getting treatment is almost equivalent to getting an addictive medicine. As a result of which, they also postpone any consultation with the psychiatrist as well. Many times, the sleep problems, though it may be the 1D problem, can be an important indicator of an underlying depression. So if at all there is a depression, sleep disturbances, I think we should give an importance to the sleep problem, get evaluated and treated also. So this is the thing which I wanted you all to focus. It initially starts with the lack of sleep in the top end. Because there is lack of sleep, they become tired the next day. And once they become tired the next day, they find it difficult to cope up with the daily jobs next day. And when they are not able to finish their daily jobs, they feel low about themselves and they worry that they are not able to complete all this. That results in again a lack of sleep, and the cycle continues. So you can clearly see how a sleep problem can gradually go on, and in a vicious cycle, it can result in a depression as well. Next slide, please.
Just a minute, sorry for the interruption. So one of the main reasons why we had Dr. Pradeep in our mind was while doing evaluation, what we found was a lot of people had very poor sleep habits. And the other most important, a lot of them had was, sleeping Sunil, very late.
Can you change the next slide? Am I audible?
He couldn't hear, I think.
You're not able to hear us?
message it. Wait, I'll message it.
Okay.
Am I audible?
So one of the main reasons we had is because we want your sleep routine to come in place. So when we did the assessment, a lot of people had this issue. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. The other common psychiatric disorder that are under-identified are pain symptoms. I think we often see many people who are elderly who come just for the pain symptoms, especially low backache. Hello. I think there is some technical glitch. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. So many times what happens is that they come with pain symptoms, especially the lower back ache, or many times there may be pain in the knees because of osteoarthritis, and the result they may not be able to walk. Many times they go on into a fear that this pain will worsen, as a result of which many people whom we see in the clinics start to hesitate to participate in any amount of mobility. They say that walking worsens the problem. They fear that they may fall down. They fear that walking will actually worsen the problem, because of which they are not willing to do any exercises. They lose their commitment to exercises, even when basically prescribed by the orthopedicians as well. So we need to be very wary that this fear of worsening of pain is one thing which can actually result in a lot of immobility as well. So the fear will result in probably not doing anything. And when you don't do anything, let's say you don't walk, you are always sitting and idle, that by itself will cause will result in a lot of disuse. So you don't use the knees. As a result, the knees becomes more stiff. As a result, again, the worries will increase. Fear that, it is so much stiff that I'm not able to walk, I may fall again. Then the fear increases even further. Again, they may not, even after the fear increases so much, they again restrict themselves from walking. So they go on with the cycle again and again. Next slide, please. This is what I told, that this is a fear avoidance model. Okay, so when there is a pain, we fear that there may be injury, a fear of movement will be there, and we restrict our movement. Because we restrict our movement, we don't use that joint. As a result, it automatically loses its strength and it becomes more painful. So again, when there's more pain, again, the fear of injury, the fear of movement, everything increases. More and more, we restrict ourselves from moving. So this fear avoidance model is one of the things which is commonly talked about, especially for people who restrict from doing exercise in a regular basis. Next slide, please. So I will give you another example. This is in another setup. Let's say they feel breathless. When they feel breathless or find difficult to breathe, they fear that any activity which actually increases this gasping, they will have a fear for it. Let's say walking upstairs or walking fast. All these are activity where you can gasp for air. So they become fearful about those activities and start to avoid those activities. So they stop climbing upstairs. They stop probably walking fast. As a result, they become less and less active. And as a result, the muscles become more and more weaker. So weaker muscles use more oxygen, though, and it becomes less efficient. Again, they may feel more breathless. Okay. So this is that cycle of probably the fear, which results in more inactivity as well. Okay, next slide, please. So I thought I will ask Surendra to have make a small break so that I will, the next few minutes probably I will focus more on what to do if things like this happen again and again. Over to Surendra.
So we'll have a quick activity, right? All of you definitely enjoy, you know, the brain exercises, right? So we'll do one of that kind today, right? So what we are going to do, tap, clap. Okay, tap, clap, tap, clap. So when you're doing this, name some. So only when you're tapping, you can say, name some. Dog, cat. So ensure that only when you're tapping on the lap, you should be able to say the animal. Okay? So I need 10 animals together. If someone is ready, we will put you on spotlight and you can try to do it. So you got it? So we're going to do tap, clap.
Say it again.
Yeah. Tap, clap. Tap, clap. So this is the action. Okay. So you're going to say, name some animals. Cat, dog, elephant. So only when you're tapping on your lap, you can say the name of the animal. Okay. Not while clapping. Only when it is on the lap, on your thighs, you should say the animal. So when if someone is ready with 10 sets, we'll put you on spotlight and you can do it. Who's ready? Chumki ma'am, Padma ma'am. Okay, Chumki ma'am.
Give us a practice.
Yeah, you are on spotlight. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, you've already told me. Have I? Should I start the names of animals?
Start. Yes, start. It's okay. 10 animals we want. That's it.
Lion, tiger, rabbit, elephant, bear, rat,
cat,
dog,
camel.
These animals are so difficult.
How many has been completed?
10.
7.
Okay.
But good try. Good try.
Anybody else?
Yeah, myself.
Yes, Padma ma'am wanted to do. I'll put her on spotlight.
I will try.
Yes, ma'am.
Cow, buffalo, cat, monkey, tiger, lion, rabbit, bear, bison.
7.
Again, seven.
You should have continued till we say stop. Okay, fine. Good try. Okay.
Now who else is ready? Mala ma'am is
Mala
ready.
Ma'am.
Kanchana ma'am, yes, we'll do it. 1 second. Yes, Mala ma'am, you can do now.
Dog. Buffalo. Rat, squirrel, bison, giraffe, zebra, tiger, cheetah, hippopotamus.
How many, Vijay? Done? 10?
How much?
No, not 10.
Not yet.
How many? How many are done? How many have done?
You seven, did seven, auntie. Again, seven.
Seven.
Oh, seven is a lucky number.
Seven is a lucky number. All of three stopped in seven.
Today, that is
who wants to try more than that now?
Kanchana ma'am is ready.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, yes, ma'am. You can unmute yourself.
Hello. dog, cat, cow, rat, hippopotamus, cow, horse.
You broke in between.
Lion, lion.
There is a pass in between.
Okay.
Give.
Anybody else?
Sarla aunty wants to try.
Yeah, Dr. Shubha wants to do. After that, we'll give it to Sarla aunty.
Cat, cow, bat, buffalo, gun.
Such a simple game, it's so tough.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's okay. Well tried. Can we put
Sarla aunty?
Sarla aunty on spotlight. Yes, aunty.
Auntie, kitne din ho gaye Sarla aunty karte.
Dog, cat, lion, tiger, elephant.
What happened?
Okay. Now we'll put Shireen ma'am is asking for a long time. We'll put Shireen ma'am on spotlight. Yes, ma'am, you can unmute yourself and you can try. Ma'am, unmute yourself.
Ma'am, unmute yourself, please.
Shireen ma'am, aap mute mein hai. We are not able to hear you. Aap unmute kijiye. Haan, yes.
Yeah. In my van, 24/11 hai number.
Cat. Say. Donkey. Lion. Tiger. Elephant. Crocodile.
Seven, but the new animal crocodile came.
thank you.
Lakshmi ma'am, you want to try? You are commenting that it is cool. Try.
who wants to try?
No, Lakshmi ma'am is commenting it is so cool. I am asking her to try.
Thanks, Vicky. I did it. I'm okay. I did it. It was fine. Okay. I did it when you were demonstrating. I did it. So I'm cool. Okay. I'm fine with it.
Right.
Okay, but thank you. I'm a little shy to come being spotlit just now.
Okay. Aruna ma'am, what's your try?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Lion.
Wait.
Cat. Dog. Deer. Fox. Elephant. Crocodile. Hippo. Bear. Deer.
How many?
You crossed the 7 mark.
Yes. Oh, you did 8.
That's a lucky number.
Okay. Okay. Because I repeated again, same.
Okay. See, such a simple thing. It activates us, makes us feel good. Yeah. There's, you know, a lot of smiles on the faces, makes us cheerful. Right?
So, attention on.
Attention gone. So now we will go on and proceed with the talk further. Okay?
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I think now Dr. Prateep can hear us.
Yeah.
From the last session, actually, we had one question. Okay. We were talking about the sleep, right?
So
actually what we found, you know, from many of the participants that, you know, when we are doing that evaluation, many are having, the disturbance in the sleep or the sleep pattern, the problem in the sleep pattern. Mm. So normally how many hours will be the, you know, right hours, you know, we can say this many hours is enough in seniors.
Okay. Probably the rough figure for Indian population is probably above 60 years, 6 hours is probably enough at the night. And for probably more than 80 years, around 5 hours is probably the adequate amount. Many times, I think we also should accept that we were probably sleeping almost for 22 hours when we are born, and we have to accept that as the as we grow and become more and more mature, probably we may have require less sleep, and probably we have to accept that and just move on.
Okay, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
So I will start the screen share again.
Sure.
So this is where we were?
Yeah, correct. Thanks. I think it was a very nice to see so many people who are very enthusiastic and really participated well in this small break activity. I felt that I was asking, we had a discussion with Sunanda as well about whether it should be a full stretch, it should be for a continuous, or whether we need to give a break. And I think we discussed and then thought that giving a break actually improves the attention. Okay, and a little activity combined at that time will really, you may all will be able to understand that some amount of activity and an enjoyable activity actually improves your mood. So it was when I was during the first phase, I think it was full of facts. So people were all bothered with a lot of facts which I told. Probably that activity which you all did made you to feel much better. Right, so we obviously know from this that some activity, enjoyable activity, if we do, definitely it will reflect in our mood. Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, Pradeep, unmute yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So let me see what we can do. Let's say if there are stress, what we can do. The common myth we all have is stress is always bad, but it may not be so. So all stress will not create any problems. There are some stress which we called eustress, which actually helps us to work better, to perform better. I think we should have at least some of it. We all would have had some of it before our exams, 12th standard exams in our childhood, right? So those are all stress actually which makes us to work hard and actually improves our performance. But when the stress levels becomes too much, then what happens? Our performance comes down. So, and another important thing about the stress is that we cannot escape from the stress, and it is totally unavoidable. So the better thing what we have to know is that we need not avoid or escape from the stress, but rather let me learn ways to cope up with it, especially using adaptive ways to cope up with it. Next slide, Simon. Yeah. So as I said, in this the picture which I have told, on the right side, the picture looks much more bright and defined, whereas on the left side of this picture, it is more smudgy. Yeah. So if the attitudes towards handling a stress changes, you can actually change from distress to eustress. So the way you look at the stress also is a very important thing. If we become more bothered by the stress and probably feel bad about it, we'll be always in distress. But we look at it in a more adaptive way. In fact, it can help you to build much better. So our idea of the next few slides is to actually make the distress and then change it to an eustress. Okay. One change is probably lifestyle changes. Okay. So one of the lifestyle changes is actually dietary changes. So if you look out a good quality diet, let's say we have a healthy fat, we have limited fast foods, we have a lot of fruits, vegetables, high fiber diets, and all those can actually improve the physical health. That is, our own body becomes much better, our heart becomes much better, our weight is much better, it becomes less. So we become more and more healthy. And as a result, our mind is also very good. So when our mind is also very good, it also actually helps our body to stay healthy as well. So if you look out, the diet by itself actually improves our body also and also our mind. And body and mind have a very good connection between each other. If one stays healthy, the other also stays healthy. If one stays unhealthy, the other also becomes unhealthy. So diet is one way to modify this relationship between our body and mind. Okay, next slide, please. So this is the thing which I got it. I think this is a thing from the Glowing Ink program itself. So this is one of the another mode we use to actually improve the mood. So there were days several years back, I think exercise was done as a routine for many people. We were all not sure what is the relationship between exercise and mood. Does really exercise improve our mood? Really, what changes it causes in our brain? So we were not sure at all. So there were no actually any guidelines of how to use exercise. But off late, we are getting a lot of scientific evidence that by exercise, that is especially specifically some exercises can actually improve our mood. Okay, so let's look at it. Next slide, please. So I'm not going to the details of this. This is one slide with this brain image. The red areas are basically the areas where basically you have a low stimulation. If you look out, there is something what I've written as opioid. So opioid are nothing but there are some chemicals in our brain which basically makes us to feel good. Okay, so what happens is that, so whenever we have a delicious meal, there are our brain has certain areas which becomes very active. So whenever you enjoy something doing, those areas, this chemical gets released. These chemicals are otherwise called as happy hormones. So whenever we do something happy about it, like exercise or having a good meal or meeting a person whom you like and you connect with the social person whom you like and enjoy an activity, whatever you do, these happy hormones are released in important parts of our brain. So as a result of which, that actually elevates our mood. Okay, next slide, please. So these are called as happy hormones or otherwise called as called endorphins. Okay, so these endorphins, interestingly, these endorphins are the same compound which can reduce our pain as well. So whenever you do some activity, you exercise a lot and you make that happy hormones pump, it gets released in your brain again and again. And when it gets released, it actually reduces your pain all over the body. So it becomes a cycle. So you do exercise, happy hormones are released, but we feel happy. And as a result of which, pain comes down. So you can do more exercise. So as a result of which, gradually the body and the mind are actually connected through these pathways. Next slide, please. So how this physical exercise benefits mental health? Next slide. It does in various ways. One of the ways is probably it improves our mood, as I told now, because it releases happy hormones. It actually improves our self-esteem. So the capacity that I can also do, or the confidence that I can also do, that actually improves our mental health. Okay, and it lowers the risk of depression because, as I told, that exercise elevates our mood and keeps us more happy. So the chances of depression are less. So even when you are faced with some stress, because there is an exercise, it prevents you from becoming more and more dull. Okay, and also it can also improve our concentration. So in fact, what I told about the dementia, the memory problems, that and all actually improves with exercise. And now exercise is one of the main main treatment intervention for people who have memory problems during the early stage. Modality or this intervention has very good evidence that it can slow memory problems. Okay, and when we do a lot of exercise, we become automatically more fatigued, as a result of which our sleep also actually improves. And we can also reduce our stress. So multiple areas that exercise can improve the mental health. Next slide. So this is one small diagram which I wanted to, this is actually a continuance of the diagram which I spoke in the past about the fear avoidance model. So when we have a pain, we have a fear that we will fall, we will fear that the pain will increase with movement. So we restrict ourselves, we are disabled, and we become more and more restricted. As a result, pain becomes more and more. But when we control ourselves and we don't do exercise, we go into the cycle again and again. So we become more and more restricted. As a result, pain becomes more and more in intensity. But whenever there is a pain experience is there, but you still overcome that pain, you reduce your fear and you confront your fear and start to exercise, actually it may result in recovery. So as I told, exercise, as I told in the past slides, it releases lots of happy hormones. As a result, pain will actually come down. So whenever we have a fear that the pain will increase, that is the time we should not become restricted. We should probably become less fearful and confront our fear and actually do more exercise. And then you will feel that actually the pain reduces. So this is the confrontation technique we use when they have a lot of pain, especially in elderly. Next slide, please. So another thing about I told about dietary changes which can help mood and body. Next, I told about the exercise which can improve our body and mood. The third thing which I wanted to talk about is probably how to improve sleep. Next slide. So I have given few suggestions for improving your sleep. Most of the time, the thing which most of the time people have are these sleep-related beliefs or something what we called as dysfunctional beliefs. These are beliefs when people have actually will worsen the sleep. I will give you an example. Let's say I'm not able to sleep now, so I stay in the bed for a long time and I'm not able to sleep. So automatically, all humans will probably think, why the hell I'm not still sleeping? Okay, so if I'm not sleeping, what will happen tomorrow? Whether I'll be able to do all the work, whether I will be very tired, whether I may not be able to concentrate tomorrow, whether a big health problem will occur tomorrow. If I'm not able to sleep, what about my mental health? So these are all thoughts which automatically prop up. Okay, and we start to probably compare our sleep with the past. And we feel that probably 10 years back, I used to go to the bed. Within 5 minutes, I go into bed. I sleep off and I have a very deep sleep. And now I am not able to accept the current sleep that I have. Now when I take a long time to sleep, I probably get in the middle of the sleep. So these are all whenever we are not able to accept, we become more terrified by these fear, sleeplessness, and automatically these thoughts prop up. These thoughts by itself can worsen the sleep because it makes you more and more anxious. That thinking about tomorrow's problem makes you more and more anxious. As a result, whatever the sleep which is left, that also gets disturbed. Finally, again, you remain asleep, sleepless, which again increases the anxiety, which again increases all these thoughts, which worsens the anxiety. Again, you are sleepless. So we all go into the cycle again and again. So some of the techniques which we can use to improve our sleep hygiene is to probably, the first thing is probably to go to the bed at the same time and probably get up from the bed at the same time the next day, irrespective of how long we sleep. Let's say even if we have slept for 2 hours, it is okay. But we have a strict sleep hygiene that I go to sleep only at this time and probably get up at this time. So you train your body that you will not allow other time to sleep. So you restrict that whenever you sleep, you will only sleep in this time. So body has to adjust and take whatever sleep it wants in that specified amount of time. Or else what happens is when we say that I slept for around 2 hours and I try to compensate the next day morning by sleeping for a half an hour in the morning or sleeping for 1 hour in the afternoon, that night also the sleep gets disturbed and we go into the same cycle again and again. So probably we have to have a good sleep hygiene by restricting our sleep to the specific time. So we should have a very clear sleep time and also getting up time. And the next thing what we have to do for a good sleep is to create a healthy sleep environment. As far as possible, we will try to make our room where we sleep as noiseless as we can. And also probably as less light so that it is more dark as much it can be done. So that also makes a very clear, create a healthy sleep environment. The another important thing to make in the healthy, to make the environment healthy is to probably remove the clocks in that room. Because many of the time when we don't get sleep, we probably look at the clock and we feel that, oh, so much time have passed away. I have only 2 hours left to get up. So as a result, we become more and more anxious. Again, it disturbs the sleep. So probably take away the clock or mobile alarms from that place. Okay. So, and another thing which we need to do for a good sleep is probably at least switch off all electronics an hour before going into the bed. So it is well known that the light which is emitted from the screens, the LCD screens, be it TV screen, be it a mobile screen, or probably a laptop or a desktop screen, the all light basically can suppress our sleep. So it is advised that at least 1 hour before you sleep, I think you should stop all viewing electronic things, even for serials and other movies as well. Okay. And at the night, probably avoid a very large, hefty meals. Probably keep the meal at the night light. And also the reduce stress by probably doing a meditation or a yoga in regular intervals. Okay. And probably an exercise late in the evening, not at the night, probably by around 6 o'clock in the evening. Then at that time, it will make you more tired to go into the sleep. And also limit coffee at least 4 hours before the sleep. So probably if your bedtime to go to sleep is 10 o'clock, then I think you should not drink coffee, tea, or any other energy drinks like Bonvita, Horlicks, and everything after 6. You can always take warm, lukewarm milk before you sleep, but definitely not with Bonvita and other things which can also disturb your sleep. And you establish a nighttime routine. So whenever, if at all you get up in the middle of the sleep, don't panic. Probably you can always set a table or the chair nearby and probably read a boring book. When you probably get asleep, go to bed. Don't toss in the bed for too long, because tossing in the bed for too long actually brings up all these negative thoughts. And as a result, it can disturb your sleep. So always have a good routine before going into the sleep. So these are all the very important sleep hygiene practices. I will again summarize again, like having a clear time to go to bed and getting up time, and create a noiseless room to sleep and probably a dark room to sleep, and kindly turn off all electronics 1 hour before the sleep. Definitely have a light meal at the night. You can always go on for yoga, meditation in the morning to reduce your stress. Have a late evening exercise like a walking, but definitely not a night exercise. Limit coffee and tea or energy drinks after before 4 hours before the sleep, and always have establish a clear nighttime routine. Next slide, please. So the other modality which we can take to basically control our own problems is by using meditation. So meditation, various methods are there. So whichever is our preference, some are spiritual based, some are probably concentrative meditations, like example, looking at a wick of light and then concentrating for a long time, or concentrating between the eyes, like that, various type of meditations are there, which if done in the morning, it can definitely be of great use to reduce your stress, depression, anxiety, and also it can also improve your sleep problems and also improve your concentration and memory. So meditation is one good idea also, which we can be used probably to improve our mental health. Yeah. So I conclude with all this saying that I think many people would be aware of Usha Soman. She is an enthusiastic, young by heart person. And you would have seen her having push-ups and probably having a long marathons. So at this, at the end, I wanted to say that being fit and probably doing a lot of exercise not only improves our body, but also keeps our mind young. So age is just a number. So it is just our readiness, whether we are ready to improve our stress is what we have to think about. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep. Yeah, now you can ask question. If you have any question, you can ask the doctor now.
Yes, Dr. Padma, you can go on.
Good evening. I'm also a medical doctor. I very much appreciated your talk.
Thank you. Thank you.
You must remember Dr. Gangadhar, who was the director.
Yeah.
I'm probably this thing or even more senior. I appreciate your talk and appreciated your point. Anyway, do you recommend any supplements for the seniors to improve all these cognitive functions, memory, and general strength? There are specific supplements. Mm. I would like you to touch upon just one or two points.
Sure. One area, I mean, as of now, multivitamins probably at a high dose, which are water-soluble vitamins like B12, B6, thiamin. These are all vitamins which comes most of the time in a multivitamins complex. So high dose vitamins are probably useful in some people to improve their concentration. Similarly, there are something called omega-3 fatty acids, so which we get in fish liver oil and other. So that is another one vitamin supplement, over-the-counter drug, which we can actually take to improve our mood. But other things, like let's say there are molecules like ginkgo biloba, those are all probably has to be practitioner, has to be seen. And probably after evaluation, if it is necessary, it can be given. Okay. But multivitamins can be safely taken as a high dose, sure. Multivitamins.
So there is a congratulatory measure from Dr. Shanti Gunasinghe.
Thank you.
She's also a gynecologist. She says it's a wonderful, clear talk. And we also have a message from Lakshmi Vishwanathan, ma'am. In the age of webinars, this is the most informative, useful, and comprehensive one. A big thank to all the three of you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any questions? This forum is open now for questions. Mm.
Good evening, doctor.
Yeah, good evening.
My name is Mala. Actually, I just wanted to know about the dementia and Alzheimer's. Because my mother-in-law, she was a very, very active person. In her 80 years, she used to travel alone from Bangalore to Chennai. And there she used to go by bus to Trivandrum. But afterwards, she came to live with us. And he had a dementia, hallucination and all. So I'm surprised how we get, what we will be the reason for that.
Most of the time, ma'am, the dementia is more genetic. So we don't know what is the reason why some people develop dementia while some are not. But there are some factors which we feel are risk factors for dementia, diabetes, hypertension, and some lifestyle factors, like say having smoking, alcohol, and probably more fatty foods. These are all some risk factors, and probably head trauma, like any head injury in the past. These are all some factors which we know that it is associated with risk of dementia. I'm clear here that not that all people who have diabetes and hypertension don't go into dementia. I want to be clear here that that is a small risk. Probably if they have a diabetes and hypertension, probably the risk of having dementia is little higher. Not that all people with diabetes and hypertension end up over there. So there are some genetic thing of some carrier alleles are there. If it is tested, some people familiarly, these Alzheimer's can come up. So from that point of view, if they have that gene in their body, there is a little higher chance for dementia. Otherwise, it is very difficult to actually predict who will actually have dementia and who will not. But whatever be it, at the elderly, having a balanced diet, probably less fatty diet, and having a regular aerobic exercise are two important things which can definitely slow down our concentration or memory problems. So currently, as of now, even people who present with minor memory problems, we put on into this program of regular diet and probably regular exercise programs and having regular social activity. Social connectedness, if it is there, it actually slows down the progress. So these three things, diet, exercise, and social connectedness, three important things can definitely slow down the progress. But at the later stage is where medicines have some role. Probably at the later stage, diet, exercise, and social connectedness may not bring a big change. But at the, during the initial stages, it definitely has a good role.
I think Dr. Kamala has a question.
Yeah, sure. I have a question, doctor. One of the psychologists or psychiatrists, I should say, sometime back, he was giving a lecture in my institute in Hyderabad. And he said, if up to 80 years you have been free of any Alzheimer's or any dementia and things like that, it is highly unlikely you would develop it.
Correct.
Is this correct?
Yeah. Usually, the most of the people develop dementia between 65 to 75. So chances of first time having a problem after 80 is very rare.
Very rare. Which I wanted to know is, somebody is taking sleeping pills to sleep. And they are unable to sleep without that. It's a very simple one, like an alprazolam or something. I'm a doctor. Alprazolam or something like that, which was earlier prescribed to it becomes a habit. Are there any problems associated?
Yeah, ma'am. We do see a lot of people, let's say we have alprazolam. Initially, for 1 or 2 years, they are okay with the lower dose. But gradually, once they become dependent on it, we see that they gradually increase the dose. Many times, it is our innate tendency to have a better sleep, and we increase the dose gradually. So whenever they go on with the high dose sleeping pills, we have seen people who have a lot of concentration problems and memory problems. And unfortunately, sometimes even after gradually taking away the sleeping pills, that memory problems continues. So what we understand is sleeping pills most of the time is better avoided. Even if it is given, probably at a lower dose is better. If they go on with the hand, the regular monitoring of it should be there. And if they develop any concentration or memory problems with sleeping pills, as early as possible, withdrawing the sleeping pills is better.
But if you withdraw, they don't sleep.
There are alternate drugs, ma'am. Like, for example, we say about this quetiapin and olanzapine. These are two other drugs which can be used in place of sleeping pills, because the sleeping pills or the benzodiazepines are probably the more problematic thing. Whereas the quetiapin or the olanzapine, they also give a good sleep.
Sorry, I didn't get it. What is that?
Quetiapin. It's an antipsychotic. It's a quetiapin or olanzapine.
Antidepressant.
Antipsychotic, ma'am. Yeah, yeah. So we off-label, we have used for so many people, and actually it improves the sleep, it gives them better sleep. But at the same time, for all my peer, whoever elders I am seeing, I just first shift from the sleeping pills to that medicine. But I more focus on these techniques which I spoke about, the behavioral techniques, like having a sleep hygiene. So I start to focus on that. In a period of around 4 to 5 months, I'm able to stop all the sleeping pills and I can keep only on sleep hygiene techniques alone. So many people, I'm able to withdraw the quetiapine also. So the first thing I do is shift from sleeping pills to quetiapine, then gradually work on the sleep hygiene techniques, slow, gradually reduce the quetiapine, and 5 to 6 months, I'm able to stop the quetiapine as well. So sleep hygiene techniques, if we are we are able to enforce them very regularly, it is quite efficacious and scientifically well proven also.
We have a question from Lakshmi, ma'am. Lakshmi, ma'am.
I have one more question.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Can I? Yes, doctor. Yes, doctor.
When you have back pains or leg pains or things like duloxetine or prothiazide is prescribed.
Mm-hmm.
She's asking what is prescribed. Can you repeat, ma'am? Your voice got a little cracked.
I'm sorry. Maybe this room is not good. So sometimes when you have a pain somewhere, like a back pain, chronic back pain, or any chronic pain anywhere, people want to prescribe prothiazide, duloxetine, things like that.
Yeah.
So is that good?
Yeah, ma'am. This basically, these are tablets.
They're all psychotic drugs. Why should they be prescribed?
Okay. These are probably drugs which we use when there are pain symptoms, but when we do an MRI, the spine, everything looks normal, and the low back pain still persists. So in that time, people think about whether it is psychological pain rather than probably a spine related pain. Similarly, the knee pain also, if it cannot be explained by an underlying arthritis, many times the psychological component also would have got added to it and it would have worsened the pain. So the psychological component can actually worsen the pain. So in that point, these two drugs are actually antidepressants, which have a selective pain inhibiting property. So they act in the spinal level. So they don't allow the pain from the leg to pass it to the brain. So we don't perceive the pain in the brain. So it does not make the nerve numb, but probably it cuts off that signal in our spinal level itself. So this duloxetine and prothiazide are very good antidepressants for pain symptoms if an underlying psychological component is also contributing to the pain.
How do we find out that? I mean,
the orthopedicians
don't look into those angles at all. They simply say, why don't you take this? And I mean, it's for a person who knows about it, it's very difficult.
Correct.
But a person who knows that it is a sort of an antidepressant, it's very difficult to take those things.
Correct.
I asked you.
Many times, many of the physicians don't use this as the first thing. So many times they go on with multiple doctors, shopping from one doctor to another. So most of the time doctors prescribe when they feel that all other things which can explain the pain actually in the spine is normal, everything is normal, but still they complain of pain. Then they think it may be a psychological component, then they add it. And if the pain is not characteristic of that one, so it is every day it changes in its position, and probably the distribution of the pain is not the classical of a spinal pain, then this can be thought about. So when there is something atypical about the way the pain is presented, then psychological component can be thought. Many times, what we see commonly is depression. It may be actually they may really have depression. But when they have a depression, the pain symptoms are the most common way they present in elderly. So whenever there is a pain symptom, which is very atypical, definitely we need to think about depression, proactively look for depression. And if it is there, like significant sleep problems, sadness, not showing interest in activities, then we should strongly suspect depression and treat the depression with duloxetine or an prothiazide. The once the depression improves, pain also will improve.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Lakshmi ma'am.
No, I'm fine. Thank you. No problem. No question from you. Except to say, Vyasa, you're fantastic.
Okay. If anyone has any other questions.
Krishna, sir, wanted to ask a question. Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Yeah, doctor, very nice lecture. I really enjoyed it. Now, my problem is I have been working for the last almost 45, 50 years. I continuously work.
And sir, can you be a little loud? I'm finding difficulty here.
Last 45, 50 years, I've been continuously working. And during the pandemic, I gave up. I was with Hindustan Liver. Then I started my own consultancy. I was working 6 days a week, traveling all over the country and all that. All of a sudden, after the pandemic, you know, the business I was doing, I was not able to do that because I was in supply chain, visiting factories, all these things were standstill. So I'm doing something from operating, some doing some legal work and that kind of thing. But I've got so much time in hand. Because I'm at home, I eat a bit more. I am putting on weight and all that. And I think I got a lot of time on my hand. So
So the last few sentences, can you repeat, sir? Sorry, I'm...
You are not that audible, sir. Please.
Yeah, your volume is
too
low.
Louder.
Yeah, I think I have got a lot of time in my hand. I don't know how to spend the time now.
Okay. I think this happens for many people post-retirement. That also is the same thing what you are... now suddenly the pandemic has created a new retirement for you. So it's a temporary retirement probably. We will soon pick up with all the jobs. I think this thing which you told is not unique for our elderly alone. I think most of the people now face this vacuum. They suddenly are stopped from doing that. They are stopped from doing anything. And they are legally punished. They can be legally punished for doing something. And they find that this being idle is one of the things which is driving them very, very, very crazy. So what many people go on with depression because they don't know what to do. And many people start to think about the most negative things of their life or the future. So that all suddenly the room for all these negative thoughts gradually expand. Yeah. So the better thing at this point of time is probably still hoping that we are soon going to come out. Okay. Until then, probably having a regular schedule in a day will definitely help us. Schedule which includes probably the time to get up, probably the time to exercise, the time to have a breakfast, and probably having specific times for some jobs. It may be a passion, like let's say a gardening or a drawing which you have long left, or something, learning an online course, anything which you like probably will be one important thing which can be filled in that time. And along with it, probably improving your social connectedness, that enjoying a call with people. So having a specific time for actually speaking with others, enjoying little moments, having a Zoom call, having a meet within the relatives. I think these are all ways to overcome this boredom. If we don't correctly deal with this boredom, as you say, many times it can engulf us and probably result in a lot of vacuum, and then we may go in for a depression. So at this point of time, keeping the hope and structuring your day with various activities, keeping it regular every day, and then hoping that you will be back to your work will be one of the good strategy to use at this point of time, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks.
So I should say one thing here. We have a wonderful set of senior citizens with us. So even for us to learn this online thing, it took us time. But all of you have been very quick in adopting to this online way of things and going with it, right? So that is one step towards making life better.
That's true.
And we should say, the active participation of everyone, whatever we do, we are really appreciating that. you know, that is the one way you are making you, you know, engaged in something. That is the thing, right? That's what, you know, doctor is also saying now.
Yeah.
You should engage yourself in some activity, right?
We are growing young like you, Sunanda and Biji, with you, definitely.
Yeah.
My appreciation.
That is our goal, man.
Very cool and informative talk by Dr. Pradeep. All the best.
Thank you.
Any other questions from anyone?
Okay. Can we conclude the session, Vijay? Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Pradeep, for the, you know, wonderful presentation today. It's very, you know, like informative and interesting to everyone. And we observed that many of them actually, they were taking notes. When you are presenting, you know, like in few of the slides, they were taking notes about, you know, the sleep pattern and everything actually. So we believe that, you know, it is very informative and they will benefit from, you know, your presentation today. Thank you very much for your time and effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the opportunity given as well. I think it was a nice opportunity to interact with so many people and this in this pandemic as well. Yeah. So thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Thank you, Doctor. Very useful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Pradeep. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for more useful sessions. Looking forward to more.
More sessions, yeah.
Sure, ma'am. We'll arrange it. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.